Dr. Michael Isakoff and Dr. Stephen Isakoff here today with us. Dr. Michael Isakoff is an assistant professor of pediatrics at the Connecticut Children's Medical Center in Hartford, Connecticut, and an attending physician in the pediatric hematology and oncology. He earned his medical degree from the New York University School of Medicine, and he then moved to New Haven, Connecticut for his pediatric residency, and from there completed his fellowship in pediatric hematology and oncology in the Children's Hospital Boston Dana-Farber Cancer Institute program. He has been at the Connecticut Children's Medical Center since 2005 and has been actively involved in clinical research with a special interest in sarcomas. Dr. Stephen Isakoff is an instructor in medicine at Harvard Medical School and an attending physician in the Gillette Center for Breast Cancer at the Massachusetts General Hospital Cancer Center. He also earned his medical degree in the New York University School of Medicine, as well as a combined PhD in molecular biology. He completed his residency in internal medicine at Brigham Women's Hospital in Boston, and then joined his brother as an adult medical oncology fellow at the Dana-Farber Mass General Fellowship, where he also studied the basic biology of cancer in the Department of Cell Biology. He joined the oncology staff at Mass General in 2006 with a focus on clinical and translation studies in breast cancer.
Introduction is quite a mouthful. You make my brother and I sound we've certainly done much more than we have. It's kind of embarrassing to be a Yankees fan these days. Completely don't support steroid use, and A-Rod can go anywhere in any other team if you want him in Boston. And it's also another birthday you didn't mention is it's my grandmother's 93rd birthday today as well, first day. So my brother and I gave this talk, knowing Dr. Huber now, we were just talking about for 7 years, and we gave this talk in 2004, and so we appreciate the opportunity to come back. And we were both extraordinarily impressed with the program that you guys do here. We had a tour of the facility afterwards and got to watch what your predecessors did. It was a really remarkable program, so we give you guys a lot of credit for showing up here early Saturday morning every week and taking care of the kids that you do. So we hope what we're going to talk about today will help a little bit with some perspective on cancer. So the way we've divided this is I'll give about a 10-minute introduction or so, just sort of a general overview of cancer, just some general principles, and then I'll turn it over to my brother, who's actually the pediatric oncologist, and he'll talk a little bit more with a case-based approach to showing a few cases and going over the, some general points about pediatric oncology and try and focus this relevant on some of the issues that kids with cancer have and some of the disabilities or impacts that might have. And we'll try and end in about 45 minutes or so, 50 minutes, and give you guys time for questions. Our last talk, there were plenty of questions afterwards. This topic always seems to bring up questions either in the adult or pediatric side, and we're certainly happy to take them at the end. So just to start with the question, what is cancer? So what cancer is not is one disease. Cancer is at least over 100 different diseases. The definition I put up here is that it's a group of diseases caused by uncontrolled growth of cells in a part of our body that basically have the ability to grow and divide in an uncontrolled fashion. And then the key part is that it can spread to other parts of the body or spread locally into tissues where it's not supposed to. The word metastasize generally means the ability of cancer to spread from the primary site where it originates into another part. So in the cancer that I deal with on a daily basis, breast cancer obviously originates in the breast. But when it metastasizes, that means that a breast cancer cell travels outside of the breast and it shows up in the liver or in the bones. And that's what metastatic disease is. And that's really, for most cancers, what causes the life-threatening complications. It's not necessarily the cancer where it grows, because in many cases that can be cut out. But it's when it spreads to organs and to multiple organs that can no longer be cut out. When we talk about the stage of cancer, sometimes there's confusion about this. What the stage is a description for us about how advanced the cancer is. in many cancers, in some of the solid tumors, and often in adults, but also in children, we'll use what's called the TNM staging system, which basically means we describe the size of the tumor, we describe whether any lymph nodes that are around the tumor are involved, and we describe whether it's spread beyond the primary site. And taking these things into account allows us to put together a stage number. The higher the stage, and many cancers are staged on a scale of either 1 through 4 or 1 through 3, the higher the number generally means the cancer is more advanced. The lower the number means it's less advanced or still in the local setting. And really it's a way for us to do clinical trials and look at the epidemiology of cancer. It's a way for us to categorize things and then sort of look at outcomes. And survival rates generally are better with lower stage cancers, and as the stage goes up. So that's what we mean by stage. And then a tumor is really just a general term that means a lump of cells, basically. In general, we talk about it as a group of cells that form a lump that's abnormal. But the word tumor itself does not necessarily mean cancer. So generally, tumors can be benign or malignant. Benign tumors are abnormal growths of benign cells, and the key part about that is that those cells have not developed the ability to spread beyond that lump of cells. A malignant tumor is really what we're talking about when we're talking about cancer. And what that means is not only do they form a lump, but cells from that lump can then invade into the surrounding tissue, and more importantly, can often spread to other tissues. When we talk about tumors, leukemias, we generally don't talk about tumors per se. They really don't often form lumps, although they can sometimes in parts of the body. So tumors usually refer to more of the solid tumors. So let me just describe some of the general overview of how we categorize cancer. So I mentioned cancer is really hundreds of diseases, and at the broadest scale, we can separate them into what we call the solid malignancies, the hematologic malignancies that occur in the blood, and we refer to those as the liquid tumors to distinguish them from the solid tumors, and since they're in blood. And then there's sort of other tumors that are a little bit harder to lump together and categorize. So within the solid tumors, we generally can divide them into two branches, carcinomas and sarcomas. And carcinomas generally refer to many of the tissues that we think of that are called epithelial tissues, so breast tissue, lung tissue, colon tissue. And the sarcomas are generally cancers that arise from a little bit more of the embryonic type tissues. Things like in the muscle or in the bone often cause sarcomas. And within the carcinomas, as I mentioned, breast cancer, lung cancer, colon cancer, prostate cancer are sort of the most common ones in this category. And within the sarcomas, we generally think of bone, muscle, fat tissue can actually cause cancers and some of the cancer tissue. And in the second part of the talk, in the pediatric population, sarcomas are much more common than carcinomas. We usually don't see these kinds of cancers children, although in some inherited forms of cancer, you can see some cancers in the GI tract. But really, it's the sarcomas that are the more common solid tumors in children. In the hematologic cancers, we generally can divide them into leukemias and lymphomas. Lymphomas tend to be cancers that arise from the immune cells that often park themselves in the lymph nodes. And that can be the inguinal lymph nodes, the lymph nodes in the underarm, and more commonly lymph nodes somewhere else within the body, deeper down in the body. And that's in distinction from the leukemias, which generally are cancers of cells that arise in the bone marrow themselves. And my brother will talk a little bit more about that. And then some of these other cancers that don't easily fit into these categories, primary brain cancers, arising in the neurologic tissue. Melanomas also don't easily fit into this kind of tissue description. So what causes cancer? The remarkable thing about Google is you can really find anything you want. So this is James Watson. He was one of the co-discoverers of the structure of DNA, and this is a bobblehead Google insert. What this really is meant to use is just showing that if we take a person and then we delve down and look at one level at the organ system, and then if you amplify that and look one level down further at the cells, inside the nucleus of the cells, controlling all the function of what goes on inside the cell is DNA, and this is just a calendar type showing the there is a chromosome. This one happens to be a male since it has an X and a Y at the bottom here. And then if we go up looking at a microscope even further, this is just a cartoon showing the double strand of DNA that James Watson is holding and helped discover the structure. But what cancer ultimately is really caused by are mutations in our DNA. And it's mutations that cause a dysregulation of the normal control functions that control cell growth and cell division. And so most of us, our DNA, there are some variations in all of our DNA, but most of our cells are able to maintain good control and understand the signals about when it's appropriate to grow and divide, when it's appropriate not to. And there's even signals within a cell that say something's wrong here, it's time to commit this program called programmed cell death that sort of helps cells eliminate themselves when a mutation in the DNA happens. However, when certain mutations accumulate, what can happen is that those signals are now dysregulated. So normally, hormone traveling through the body might tell a cell it's time to stop growing or it's not appropriate to grow, but a mutation might now prevent the cell from understanding that signal and the cell might continue to grow and divide. In addition, when there's dysregulation, cells normally are told something's wrong here, I should now eliminate myself from this tissue. Mutations can happen that actually prevent the cells from doing that, and so normally when the cell would do that, it doesn't, and it ends up growing. And so really, all cancer originates from mutations in our DNA. And so what can cause those mutations? So cancer is a great example of nature versus nurture. It's probably, would be better said nature and nurture, because often it's a combination of things, and your genes don't necessarily, they can, in certain inherited situations, they can certainly predispose you with a very high chance of getting cancer. But very often it's an interaction between the environment and your gene. In children, this is probably less so, and in the second part of the talk, you'll hear a little bit more about that. But environmental causes, I think many of these are familiar with, really smoking. It's responsible for the majority of lung cancer, the majority of head and neck cancers, and has a large association with pancreatic cancer, probably with breast cancer as well. Alcohol intake is another large risk factor. Head and neck cancer, if you smoke and you drink, or people with head and neck cancer, smoking and drinking is probably the majority of the reason for that. Stomach cancer can be caused from alcohol use. And then there's also an association with breast cancer and other cancers. Radiation is a well-known cause of cancer. That can be from sun exposure. Melanomas are very commonly caused from overexposure to the sun. And then radioactivity, so, and this actually is important as it regards to children, because some of the diseases that children get, such as lymphomas, can be treated with radiation, but then that can be a problem as they grow into adulthood. Girls, for example, who were treated with radiation during their teenage years when the breasts are developing, are actually at very high risk of developing breast cancer in their 30s. And then studies looking at children who are exposed to radiation, for example, during nuclear bomb detonations, had very high rates of childhood and adult cancers later on. Then there's a whole bunch of environmental carcinogens that are around. Asbestos is a well-known one. There are many other chemicals that exposure to can increase the risk of cancer. Lack of activity has been associated with an increase in cancer risk. So. Exercise has been shown in many studies and in many cancers to help reduce the risk of developing cancer. Diet probably has an important role as well. In breast cancer, for example, a high fat diet has been shown to increase the risk of cancer. Not clear if this is related to diet is then associated to the development of diabetes due to obesity, which is then related to an increase in the hormones such as insulin, which then can set you up for an increased risk of developing cancer. But certainly changes, Western cultures tend to have higher cancer rates in many situations compared to developing countries, and in large part it's thought that diet might be a key part of that. And then viral infections, and this is really an important one, cervical cancer is almost exclusively caused by the human papillomavirus, which is a sexually transmitted disease, and which is what pap smears are intended to be for. Pap smears have really changed over the recent years. Now instead of just doing an analysis of the cells in the cervix, there's actually an analysis now where you can look to see if there's an HPV infection. And certain HPV infections are associated with cancer, certain are just associated with developing cervical warts, but without actually causing cancer. And now this now there's a vaccine for this that a lot of teenagers are should be getting now. And then lymphoma can be associated with the Epstein-Barr virus as well. And then genetic causes, age seems to be a big predisposing factor for cancer, for lung cancer and breast cancer. Certainly the older you get, the increased risk you have. There are certain inherited mutations that run in families. So the BRCA1 and 2 genes are known to be present in about 5%, 5 to 10% of breast cancer patients. And if you have one of these mutations in your genes, your risk of developing breast cancer over the course of your life could be as high as 80%. Colon cancer also has some familial genetic predispositions. And then there are several others. Mutations in a gene called P53 can predispose children to brain tumors and leukemias, and adults to other cancers. And then the majority of cancer is probably caused by these random mutations. And the truth, when patients ask, why do they get this cancer, most of the time the answer is we just don't know. There's trillions upon trillions of cells in your body, and to get all those cells requires trillions of cell divisions. And with each cell division, the chance for random genetic events to happen in the cell exists. And so the likelihood of developing something is common. And your body will never stop doing that. In a sense, that's how we all evolved, is by these random genetic changes. Some of them are beneficial, but some of these can cause cancer. So just one slide to give an overview of just the terms we use when we talk about treatment. So for the solid tumors that I mentioned, surgery is still really the mainstay of treatment. If you can't cut it out from where it originally sits for many of these solid tumors, that's a problem, and that's still really the first approach. Following that, chemotherapy and radiation are often two modalities that we use. And just to introduce you to some of the terms that we use, neoadjuvant is a word that we use to mean treatment that you give before surgery to try and shrink a tumor and make it more accessible for the surgeon to cut out. And adjuvant means after the surgeon's cut it out. We know that for many cancers, if we don't give you additional treatment after that, we know that there's a fairly high rate that the cancer will come back. And so adjuvant treatment is really treatment given after the surgery to try and destroy any residual microscopic cancer that might still be there. Chemotherapy also can be very effective alone in some cancers without surgery. So testicular cancer, for example, which is something we see in adults and in children, can be cured almost exclusively with chemotherapy. Lance Armstrong had testicular cancer and was cured from chemotherapy. And that's really a great example in the solid tumors of how chemotherapy has really saved lives. And then palliative treatment is when cancer has spread beyond the curative phase, where we no longer have treatments that can cure. We can give chemotherapy or radiation in what's called a palliative setting, which means to relieve suffering. And so the goal of this would be to shrink the tumors to try and control the cancer, but not with the idea that we're going to be able to cure it. And we do this often in advanced cancers, not because sometimes it's to prolong life and sometimes it's to reduce symptoms for patients. And these are very effective strategies for that. As opposed to the solid tumors, for lymphomas and leukemias, surgery is really not part of the treatment. There's really no organ or no tissue to remove by surgery. Chemotherapy is really the mainstay of treatment for these types of cancers. And many years ago, and actually Sidney Barber from Dana-Farber, one of the co-founders in the 1950s, was one of the pioneers in showing that combinations of chemotherapies can actually cure some forms of leukemias and lymphomas. And then for lymphomas, sometimes radiation is used in combination with that. But that's a disease where combination chemotherapy has really made a huge impact. Radiation, generally not used for the leukemias alone, the tumors that arise in the bone marrow. But radiation is commonly used for Hodgkin's disease and non-Hodgkin's disease, which are two types of lymphomas. And then in bone marrow transplants, that's a technique that we use in leukemias, lymphomas, and some other blood disorders. What that involves is very high doses of chemotherapy, so much so that you destroy all of your residual bone marrow. You really have nothing left to recover from. And so in order to allow the person to have blood cells, red blood cells and white blood cells, you have to give them either their own bone marrow that you took out beforehand, or sometimes bone marrow from a donor, from another person, often a relative, but sometimes an unknown person. And then in the last 10 years or so, there's really been a huge movement toward what's called targeted therapies, which are different than the standard chemotherapy that many of you think of, where we give drugs that cause a lot of side effects and things. Targeted therapies really evolved from our understanding of some of the very specific Achilles heels of cancers. We've now developed very specific treatments that can attack those Achilles heels. They often have fewer side effects. Often there are oral medications, which has made a big impact in our ability to treat patients. And some examples for those are a drug called receptors for breast cancer, which only attacks a specific molecule that's on those breast cancers and has very low toxicity. Gleevec is used in chronic myelogenous leukemia, sometimes seen in younger populations. And there's now, this list is probably about 30 or 40 long now of FDA-approved targeted therapies. This has really revolutionized our cancer treatments and will continue to do so. So at this point, I'll turn it over to Mike.
Childhood cancer survival rates have improved greatly over the last 30 to 40 years. Greater than 60% of children with cancer do survive. The number is probably more closer to 70%, actually. And one in 820-year-olds is a cancer survivor. This is the leading causes of death broken up. You can see here that cancer is the second most common. You know, other random things that I think they just had difficulty in isolating the exact cause, but accidents are the major issue. And there are a large distribution of the types of cancers, but as Stephen pointed out, some of the things you don't see up here are carcinomas. You don't see colon cancer, breast cancer, prostate cancer, we don't see. You can see that leukemia is the most common cancer that we see in childhood. Steve also mentioned the sarcomas. And brain tumors actually make up the second most common cause of cancer in children. So what causes cancer in children? We talked a lot about, or you heard a lot about environmental causes, drinking and smoking and all the bad things that adults do. But what about in kids? So I don't know if many of you have seen too many kids walking around or things like that. I think that's a doctored photo, I hope, rather than asking some kid to do that. Not too many kids are doing that either, but you never know. you can't find anything. environmental factors are really not what we believe contribute greatly to the cause of childhood cancer. There are probably some things that may contribute. If you live in Woburn, you may know that there's some history there. Anybody grow up in Woburn? Yeah. So you probably know that in the late 70s, early 80s, there were concerns about toxic waste dumping and a cancer cluster in that region of children that developed leukemia. That's one of the rare times that you can hear something like that. Most of the time, we don't know. But there are some genetic predisposition syndromes and some specific mutations that can lead to an increased risk of cancer. And some of the syndromes that we see that you may interact with kids either in your clinic or at other times are syndromes such as trisomy 21 or Down syndrome, Becker-Hewman syndrome, which is more rare, but you may see that. Wager syndrome, which is a combination of a variety of defects, including Wilms tumor, which is a cancer. This is an eye defect, genito and urinary abnormalities, and mental retardation is the R. And then neurofibromatosis. Have people in the room seen any of these syndromes? Yes? Yeah. At least trisomy 21 is common enough that that you would more likely see. So Down syndrome or trisomy 21 is caused by an extra chromosome 21, so they have 47 instead of 46 chromosomes. It affects approximately 1 in about 1,000 live births, and there's an increased risk in older women having children. So the rate of having a child with trisomy 21 goes up if you're greater than 35. But most children, so people always talk about that older women are who have kids with trisomy 21. While it's true that the risk is greater, there are many more kids with trisomy 21 that were born to young women. There's very classic, typical facial characteristics, including broad face and flat nasal bridge, upslanting inner eye folds, floppy muscle tone. There can be cardiac defects and gastrointestinal defects. Developmental and cognitive deficits also. So with respect to cancers, there's about a 20-fold increased risk of acute leukemia compared to the general population. But the risk is really only about 2% of developing leukemia by the age of 5. So the risk is actually very small. A lot of pediatricians get very nervous when they have a child with trisomy 21 that they could be developing leukemia. But a 20-fold increased risk over an incredibly low risk is still really low. And typically, the type of leukemia that children with Down syndrome develop typically has a more favorable prognosis and responds very well to therapy even initially. Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome is a more rare disorder that has characteristic overgrowth really only occurs very rarely, 1 in 15,000 births. There's a large tongue is often associated with abdominal wall defects. They can have seizure disorder also, and cognitive function can be normal but also slightly decreased. And so they have an increased risk of abdominal tumors, typically of the kidney and liver, and we believe that this has to do with the overgrowth issues and some predisposition in the, either the rate or the size that their organs are growing seems to predispose them to certain tumors. So I want to tell you a story about Claudia, who is a girl that I met in 2002. So she, at 5 years of age, was very healthy. She started developing leg pain, lower back pain, and was seen by her pediatrician, thought to have just a regular old virus, maybe a cold. And then her parents thought she was starting to look pale and weak and wasn't eating so well. and then had a fever and was seen by her pediatrician and thought that she had swollen lymph nodes and, you know, swollen glands in her neck and probably just really had a virus. But was nervous enough that they got a blood count and there were some abnormal white blood cells. So she came to see us and had a bone marrow evaluation, which involves using sedation to make kids comfortable, laying them on their side, and then numbing up and placing a needle into the back of the hip, right where you feel a little bump. Pull out bone marrow, remove the needle, and then they wake up and are comfortable and usually don't remember the procedure. So when we looked at the bone marrow, it confirmed acute leukemia, and she was admitted to the hospital and admitted, and again, leukemia is the most common cancer that we see. So just to give an overview of what leukemia is, we've talked about it as a blood cancer, but what does that really mean? There are three types of blood cells. There's the red blood cells that carry oxygen, platelets, which are important to stop bleeding, and white blood cells, which help fight infection. So if you have a leukemia, that means you have a cancer of the white blood cells. So if you don't treat leukemia, you'll universally die. There's no ability to fight infection. As the white blood count goes up, it can make the blood very thick and viscous, and then you can, which will lead to death. So this is a blood smear. When we look under the microscope, we see red blood cells. They're normal. And then these are white blood cells, or at least one type of the white blood cells called neutrophils. And those are cells that help fight infection. And then this is an example where we have red blood cells. The quality of the smear here isn't quite as good. So they are the same cells as what we see there. And then there are these big cells that clearly look different than these normal cells. They're much bigger than white blood cells, and they have this big area here is their nucleus. And this is what leukemia looks like. Big abnormal cells that are growing also, you know, in higher proportion than they should. There should only be a couple cells normally, and there's, you know, those cells are taking over. So children that require therapy for leukemia initially receive a period of very intense chemotherapy. They're in the hospital for typically 4 weeks, although in many cases we're actually able to get them out of the hospital as early as 1 week. But their ability to fight infection initially is almost non-existent. If they have an infection, it can be very dangerous, and so we do watch kids very closely as they're initially getting their therapy. And then generally, therapy will be about 2 years. And during that time, we try and see kids go back, or try and send them back to school, and we would like them to live their lives as normally as possible. Many kids grow their hair back after an initial period of intensive therapy. They then are getting therapy that can be delivered at home, mostly by oral medication, and then come into clinic every 2 weeks or 4 weeks. And when they're not in clinic, they will be living normal lives. So this is a picture of me treating Claudia 5 years ago. It just shows me examining her, and then this is a picture of her needle into the porticap that gets inserted by a surgeon under the skin so that we can draw blood and give medicines easily without any risk of the medicines leaking into the skin, that it could go right into the vein. And actually, it's very easy. She's not smiling in that picture, but I can tell you that she was somebody that, you know, just would pull up her shirt and just stick the needle in. It didn't hurt, didn't bother her. We have cream that you can put on the skin that numbs it up so that the kids don't have pain when their ports are accessed. And then they get their medicine, and then you can take the needle out, and so then when the needle's out, they can go swimming, they can shower, bathe, participate in sports. We prefer that they don't play the full-out contact football, tackle football, but that they can play almost any sport that they want.
highly dangerous.
So the main side effects of the type of chemotherapy that we use can lower your blood count, increasing the risk of infection or leading to requirements of blood transfusion. It can also cause hair loss and nausea and vomiting. Those are the main side effects that people think of, I think, when we think of chemotherapy. We have lots of medicines to help with those side effects, except for the hair loss. We do have hair pieces, though, that I can almost guarantee you, if you saw one of our patients that was wearing a hair piece, you would not be able to tell. They're incredibly realistic. They're often with real hair, and they design them specifically for the child. And that often is one of the worst things for kids, and especially teenagers, to hear that they're going to lose their hair. So that is often worse than hearing that they're going to be nauseous or that they're going to need therapy for a year or 2 years. It never ceases to amaze me what the reaction is to hair loss versus all the other side effects. But chemotherapy often can lead to physical impairments. You can have decreased neurological function in your ability to lift your toes with some chemotherapies, which can then affect your ability to run or play sports. And generally can make you feel weak, so it can also just be harder to get through the day. Radiation can also, especially if used on the brain, can decrease cognitive function, which can lead to a lot of learning difficulties, and is then necessary to have special programs to help kids keep up in school. Some kids afterwards need to take untimed tests for like the SATs. In fact, I recently had a patient who was a very good student but was having some troubles in school. And with neuropsychological testing, it was determined that because probably related to the radiation that he received, he had some processing issues. And it was felt that he really should be able to take tests without timing. And then when he took his SATs, he scored, his math and verbal, around a 1550, which is a pretty impressive score. That, one might have thought that he was not that smart of a kid, and it really had nothing to do with how smart he was. It was just the time it was taking to process the information directly related to the chemotherapy, or the radiation therapy, and maybe both. And now he's going to be going to college and actually got a full scholarship to UConn. And then many long-term organ function issues, including cardiac function problems. And I mentioned the exhaustion and weakness, often requiring physical therapy and occupational therapy. So, one of the treatments is to decrease doses. We hate to do that because we want to maximize the therapy to treat the cancer. But if somebody can't walk because of the drug that I'm giving, then it's often not an option. You just have to stop the drug. And I mentioned physical and occupational therapy. If patients are having pain either related to a chemotherapy drug or their cancer, then they need treatment of their pain. And often with that treatment can function well. And kids need to be able to rest. If they're going to school, it's great, but their teachers need to recognize that if they're feeling tired, they need to rest and have accommodations for that. So there have been great changes in prognosis. We see that in 1970, there was that number's wrong. In 1970, for leukemia, the survival rates were about 30%. Overall, cancer treatments were really bad at that time. Today, there's more like 70% overall, and children with leukemia actually have about an 85 to 95% survival rate. In fact, in one subtype of acute leukemia, including the type that this girl, Claudia, had, it recently was reported that there's about a 98% survival. I mean, that's pretty incredible that we can cure 98% of any type of cancer, even given that that's a very select subtype. So, you know, there are things that we've tried to do to try and decrease toxicity and maintain the cure rates because of all the developmental effects and the acute toxicities that we see. Of the relapses that occur, half of them occur within the first 2 years, and then the other half pretty much occur in the next 2 to 3 years. So we have intensive follow-up after treatment in about the first 5 to 6 years after treatment. But follow-up needs to continue well beyond that because of late effects following cancer therapy, and because there are rare times when cancers of all types can recur. So Claudia now is 11 years old. She's doing fine. And actually, in her case, she, as far as I know, I haven't actually talked to her family in about 2 years, but she was having no issues, and her cancer, she's cancer-free. I'm going to go through one more case before I show that. So the next story is about a boy named Matt, who he's really a 15-year-old boy, actually. I missed a one there. And he had left leg pain and had an initial x-ray that was concerning for a mass. He had an MRI, which is one radiographic technique that we can use to really look in inside a person's body and see what the mass looked like. And that confirmed that there was clearly a mass. And he had a biopsy of this. It was a bone cancer, a sarcoma called Ewing sarcoma. This is a solid tumor that can occur in the bone or soft tissue. It's a connective tissue type of tumor. It's the second most common bone tumor and frequently most commonly occurs in adolescents and young adults. And typically, kids can complain that they're having some sort of symptom that, in retrospect, is typical to have gone on for about 6 months. You know, a little bit of fatigue, maybe a little bit of pain that was starting to wake them up at night, and then 6 months later they finally bring it to the attention of somebody that will find it. And it can cause major disability in the bone that it's in because of destruction of the normal surrounding tissue. So the best therapy that we have for this type of tumor is chemotherapy and then either complete surgical resection. Steve pointed out that the mainstay of therapy for solid tumors is surgery. So ideally, these tumors can get cut out, but sometimes they're in a location that you just can't cut it out. Like if it was on your spine, you can't just easily do a complete resection of your spine because you can cut out the spinal cord. And sometimes tumors of the pelvis are really hard to cut out because you wouldn't have a pelvic bone, you wouldn't be able to walk at all. So in those cases, we then use radiation therapy, and that is good therapy, but it comes with a lot of side effects. Radiation affects the function of surrounding tissue. It can destroy surrounding tissue, and it can also damage the genes in that tissue, which can lead to other kinds of cancers forming in the area that they're radiated. So we try and avoid it if possible. So how important is chemotherapy compared to surgery? I told you, we said that surgery is the mainstay of therapy, and it is critical to remove a tumor. But if it's the only thing that you do, although there are survivors, there are only around 10 to 15%, 11% was from one study, because we know that there's microscopic spread of these types of malignancies that need to be treated. So chemotherapy in combination with surgery leads to a 5-year survival of 75%. And unfortunately, if at the time of diagnosis the disease is spread clinically, meaning that you actually see nodules of tumor in other locations in the body, most commonly the lung, then survival is actually very poor. Even with best chemotherapy in addition to surgery, only about 20% of kids will survive 5 years. And there are many long-term side effects of not only the radiation, as I mentioned, but actually chemotherapy, because it is given through the whole body and it is essentially like giving a poison, hoping that that poison will mostly affect the tumor. It will affect the normal organs of your body, normal cells of your body, and it can lead to damage of the genes that can lead to secondary leukemias. We can see secondary bone tumors. Chemotherapy can lead to infertility. And then disabilities. If a tumor is in your leg and you need to have it cut out, then it's going to lead to a significant disability. So amputation or limb sparing surgery for extremity tumors is often done. And that can require a long-term use of a wheelchair, cane, or prosthesis. Now, most of the time, it will involve a prosthetic limb or procedures that can spare the limb that actually lead to a limited amount of decrease in function. Exhaustion during therapy leads to inability for some kids to really participate in their normal activities, and that can be very difficult. And then pain secondary to tumor. Tumors in bones are extremely painful. So this is just an example of one of the type of prostheses that somebody might use if they had a complete amputation. In some cases, having a full amputation and a prosthetic limb can lead to excellent function and maybe better than attempting to preserve the limb and just cut out the tumor and then use a prosthetic bone. Many kids, especially with the technology that's available these days, after walking on a prosthetic limb for a while, you might not notice that they even have a prosthesis unless you saw it. And then this is an example of one of the unusual, amazing surgeries that I think can be done and isn't done that often. But this is a patient that had a tumor in their thigh. And had a complete resection and had something called the rotationoplasty. And the goal was to cut out the upper portion, or the thigh basically, and then bring up the whole lower portion of the leg so that in order to create what will be a joint so that they can use a prosthesis for the lower half of their leg. So what you're seeing here is the heel. But you may notice that the person's stomach is upright, so they're not lying on their belly. What they did was they cut out the tumor and the knee and then rotated the leg around so that it was backwards, brought it up and reattached it here so that the heel actually becomes like a knee. So when you put that into, and this isn't exactly, I couldn't find a perfect example of it, but basically when you put the heel in here, that's like your knee, and you can bend it and use it like a real joint. Because that's one of the limitations with prostheses, is if you don't have a functioning joint, it's hard to walk normally. And so this allows a normal joint, and then the lower leg, and then they're just lacking the joint ability at the ankle rather than both the knee and the ankle. So it's pretty incredible. We don't do these as much, I would say, in the year 2008, as was done in the late 90s. This became a very popular thing to do in the late 90s, but they've moved away from it as other prosthetic joints have become better, and mechanical joints have come to the point where you can have a prosthetic knee, and that probably is better than this type of procedure from a function standpoint. But I thought you'd appreciate how impressive that looks. So Matt recovered from his initial surgery and went on to have 42 weeks of intensive chemotherapy. It's a long haul, and when I say 42 weeks, that's 42 weeks of planned chemotherapy, assuming that there's no delays, complications at all. And that never happens, so it's always more than a year. of therapy that, that people will receive. He went on to receive intensive physical therapy and learned how to walk again and function with prosthesis and was doing fine. So just a brief summary, and then I just wanted to show you a short video. So childhood cancer is extremely rare, but it's the leading cause of death in children. The causes are generally unknown, except for the rare genetic syndromes that I mentioned. 70%, or you know, that number seems to be going up almost every 2 to 5 years. We see that number go up. 70% of children with cancer survive. Many children function very well, don't have any noticeable impairment, and even during their treatment are going to school and functioning normally. And their disabilities are typically due to either the cancer itself or the toxicity of therapy. And those disabilities need to be recognized and treated. There are lots of impacts of cancer and the treatment that we talked about. It's important to recognize in both adults, and this number is really more based on adult data, but depression is thought to occur in about 25% of cancer patients. And I would say that that's pretty true for children also. It's probably a little bit lower, especially in the young kids, because some of the younger kids, I think, don't even realize what's going on. But that issue just in general needs to be recognized, that it is hard to hear that you have cancer and go through a cancer diagnosis, especially for a teenager. But most patients do get some degree of fatigue. Nausea and vomiting occurs but is treatable. We talked about pain and the difficulty of moving and the prostheses that are available. And then loss of appetite related to nausea and vomiting is important to recognize. Good nutrition is critical for somebody that's going through therapy. They will tolerate it a ton better if a child has good nutrition versus somebody who isn't eating well.